It is the 14th of July 2014. Get my head centered. And we are streaming live on YouTube at Beautiful Girl by Dana. Now, let me double check this. Just turn up all the way I can get it up. And, you know, it's been a while since I've done a video that actually broke down all the parts of Fukushima. Now, a banana got nothing to do with it, but beagles do, and I might cover that later. Japan had a massive earthquake. Now, we have earthquakes all over the planet, and Japan, of course, was biggest we've seen in our lifetime. And by the way, hi everybody! I almost got everything sorted out. Amthurs, Candace, Cats Alive, Nip Killer, Foggy Range, Broken Ass Islander, Punisher, Irinaril, Fix It Stupid, Amthirst, and I'm sure it's as confusing sometimes as it can be, and that's why we keep doing what we're doing. That's why we keep pushing back, and that's not going to work for me tonight, I can see that. We keep going. Oh well, so much for that theory. The quakes were so powerful that they hit Florida. They were felt in Florida, recorded after 30 minutes. Now, on the scale of all the quakes in our lifetime, that was an extraordinary event for everybody. And the fact that it was followed by a tsunami was devastating. Hang on a second, I'm slower than usual. So the tsunami took out 500 miles of coastline. It wasn't just the Fukushima Daiichi nuclear power plant, and I'm pretty sure most people understand that. I just want to clarify it, because 500 miles of coastline, there was other nuclear power plants along the way. There was 14 reactors in Japan that went into stress mode, extraordinary stress mode, and there's still, of course, everything is down. But the Daini had 4 reactors that are still, we don't know what's going on, but we do know it's really bad there. And so everything I'm talking about tonight has to be taken into consideration, that there's many other nuclear plants down there that they managed to keep the lid on. And we have forced this one, Fukushima, we have focused in on and become obsessed, because we have footage and we have pictures and all kinds of headlines, and it's easier to beat this one apart and discover how actually scary and demented the industry really truly is, that they hid it away from you. Now, just the fact that this tsunami ran through means that you can never work in there again, because it's a nuclear power plant. There was radioactive material all over the site. There's radioactive material all over that site before the tsunami came, and so the tsunami dispersed that all over the place. And I'll just keep going and I'll bring back to these topics, of course. So the tsunami took out 500 miles of coastlines, of telephone poles, 20,000 people lost their lives. Everybody was traumatized and will probably be till the day they die. But what is significant is that there was 3 melted reactors. And let me bring up Washington Post. Japan races to contain meltdown after 2 blasts, and the 3rd reactor loses cooling capacity. March 13, 2011. Contain meltdowns. To contain the meltdowns. Contain. So how can all the other media, and Ken Buechler, who finally admits it, but how could they all just get past that and say it's not as bad as Chernobyl and everything else for so long? Is an interesting question. And they're still in the media today, the people that hid this. The Bill O'Reilly's, the Fox News, the MSNBC, the CNN, the BBC, the CBC in Canada. They all hid it. But yet here it was. And once again, you know, if you go on my site and you type in Harvard or MIT or Stanford or C-SPAN, you'll get a 30-second clip with a link to the full video on March the 15th and the 16th of those institutions telling you 3 meltdowns and a melted fuel pool at number 4. So let's keep going on this one, because it's kind of important that we have a lucid conversation. I got a tendency to go whack job sometimes. So Fukushima had a study, there were two Japanese studies, and it reached Alaska in under a month. There was two other studies where it went 1,500 miles off the Japanese coast by the Japanese people. Where we're going to cover all of that as we roll through all of this. The tsunami came in and wrecked the infrastructure at Fukushima. And at the same time, it mixed it with radioactive, materials. And a band of people known as the Fukushima 50 went in, and before anybody else could or would, and to survey the damage. And this is some of the pictures. Pretty well all the pictures I'll show you, not so much tonight, but usually, is from the Fukushima 50s. And there was several hundred of these people who went and got fatal doses of radiation and took a lot of pictures. And so a lot of pictures are grainy because of all the radiation. And once again, 14 reactors at four sites were affected that we know about. There's much likely a few more. The Daini, the Daiichi had the most serious damage. And that's what we usually cover here. Now, these reactors, I want you to think about what I'm saying to you, is these reactors detonated. That's a really big site. Those stacks are around 700 feet high. That's a serious detonation. And that distributed radioactive material all over the site. And so they fill the site up with homeless people, and then they throw them away. And so that should tell you how serious what we're talking about is that they use homeless people at a nuclear power site because nuclear scientists won't go in there. Ken Buesler is not going to go in there and shake everybody's hands, I can guarantee you, from the Woods Hole Oceanographic Institution. Some staggering statements was that back on March the 15th, this was 4 days after the accident, it would be like Chernobyl on steroids if to spend fuel pool. Each reactor has 3,450 spent fuel assemblies. 3,450 spent fuel assemblies. And each assembly has around 80 rods. And each of these rods are around 12 feet. And they're about as thick as your pinky. And they're a combination of pellets in the rods that are around 18 pounds each. And a pound has 28 grams, or 500 grams. I can't even remember anymore. An ounce has 16, 28 grams, who knows. All right, a pound has 500 grams. I'm losing my mind. I can't even remember. But anyway, a gram produces more radioactive atoms than all the grains of sands and all the beaches on the planet. I must have made a mistake with my math, did I? Yeah, I'll do that later. Before, it's much worse than what I said. Aww. So anyway, there's 18 pounds in a rod, and each gram will produce more radioactive atoms. You have to understand that before I continue. And there's 3,450 centimeters, that's roughly 280,000 rods in each reactor. Now, every 18 months or so, they take all those rods, all those assemblies, and they put them in a spent fuel pool. And that's above the buildings. And some of them are missing. This is Unit 1 coming up. Now, it had 3,450 fuel assemblies in the reactor. It was running and it detonated. Now the top of it is missing. That's normally where that building is not a brand new building. It's been there for a few decades and it's been running the whole time. And so they take out 3,400. I'll come back to that one back and forth just to make sure I draw the point out there. And so every, say, less than 2 years, they'll take all of those assemblies, 280,000 rods, 18 pounds each, and a gram of it produces more radioactive atoms than all the grains of sands and all the beaches on the planet. Just imagine if you liberated all the grains of sands and all the beaches on the planet, you probably couldn't see each other. So imagine now putting an invisible snowstorm of radioactive material with just a single rod on this planet, because it's so many times more than a single gram, because it's 18 pounds, right? And the gram produces more, so you can do the math. And you should, so you can actually comprehend why we have to do what we're doing. Now the fuel, on top of these buildings was fuel pools. And they melted and detonated. And I'll cover all of that in a few minutes. But I want you to take it into consideration that every 2 years or so, they have to take the 3,450 assemblies, 280,000 rods that are 18 pounds each, and that a gram produces more radioactive atoms, and no atom is so small it can't give you cancer if you ingest it. And if you get it on your hand, you can't decontaminate it with battery acid. It doesn't work that way. And so it's important that we give you a lucid, once in a while, look at what we're talking about. And so 500 sievers is considered a deadly dose. I don't know what 1 million sievers per hour is, but it can't be good. And you'll see this formatting for the headlines show up a lot. And because the headlines on what they got done there is just linking to the original story, and he picked out what they were talking about, a salacious headline, I would call it, I guess, but a factual one, one that's important, and one that needs to convey the urgency of what we're talking about. And so that's why I use it, because it really does convey that in just a wonderful way. It's usually two or three articles down below, and a combination of those headlines is what you see at ENE News. So it's not like, it's very rare to have one story that they link to. It's usually three or four or five universities, institutions, and mainstream media. It's like Judge Report, it's no different. And so you can type in the headline, go below, and link over to the original story. So 1 million sievers per hour outside of unit one. Well, that will cook you like a chicken in a few minutes. Your kidneys will melt, your organs will melt, and you'll drop dead. And so they went in with a bulldozer and buried a lot of that over. Now that was because there was so much carnage around that place was because of the detonations. So the detonations drove the material all over the site and also ejected. And that was building one, right, we were talking about. So outside the gates of that one, that was a big picture of it. Let's come back to that picture. Outside the gates of it was 1 million sievers. What else have I got there for you? Hang on. Now, most people don't know it, but reactor one, which is what we were just looking at, and you need that visual. Reactor one melted down in 5 hours. Now, they didn't tell us that for a long time after, but it leaked out here and there, like the Washington Post when I showed you, where they alluded to the meltdown. And, you know, let me keep going because that's the whole point of what I'm trying to do here tonight. So here comes reactor two. Now, that looks pretty good. It can probably do okay to play, but you can't. Because what happened was it detonated. It didn't blow its top like number one. And here's number one again. It didn't blow its top like number one. But does that mean that it's not as bad as number one? Well, that's what you're going to learn tonight, is that the damage at that reactor, unit two, is what prompted TEPCO to discuss evacuating the Fukushima workers. That's how deadly it is. And also on unit two, now, fuel pools 1, 2, and 3 clearly had significant damages, they were telling, or alluding to on August 28, 2011. But 220 million becquerels a liter of cesium in the number 2 spent fuel pools. Well, if you drank that, you'd drop dead. It will kill you. If you're around that and you ingest that, it might take you a few weeks or a month, but you'll drop dead. Just being around a liter of that. And we'll keep going with this stuff. Yeah. So, 220 million becquerels a liter. So if it has 1 becquerel a liter, it's too much. If it has 10 becquerels a liter, it's pretty scary. If it has 200 becquerels a liter, it should be on a nuclear waste site. It should be on it if it got 1 becquerel in it, because it's a man-made radioactive ionized element. And these elements are not created by the sun. You're not going to find them on the moon. You won't find them in our solar system or in our little tiny planet's periodic table, because they took the elements and put them to a chain reaction, and they changed all the properties of the elements. And so they're considered, and this is why they're supposed to be put in a sarcophagus till the end of time, a threat to all things, to the 8.8 million species on the planet. In other words, nothing can coexist with a single becquerel. If you get it in you, you're getting it every second of every moment of your life. It's like getting an x-ray every moment of your life. Now this is unit 3, right alongside of unit 2. And this had for short a MOX fuel. And a MOX fuel is where they took missiles that's been sitting in silos, contaminating people's lands and communities, and they brought it down and they put it to the chain reaction again. Now, the ionized radiated elements, originally going to the chain reaction one time, makes them 2 million times more dangerous, more toxic, more carcinogenic than what they were originally before they went to the chain reaction. But because they had processed it to refine the materials, uranium, it was already very dangerous. But putting it through the chain reaction, you change the gammas, the emitters, the gammas, the betas, the alphas, the neutrons, the x-rays, 2 million times worse. Now, when you let it sit around in a silo for a few decades, you change those properties again. And we don't know nothing about that. There is no studies on this. We lock up 4,340 studies every day, 3 a minute, into the private corporation, Ivory Towers. And so all the peer-reviewed academic studies that we need to find are locked away, and you have to pay thousands of dollars to read just even one of them sometimes. Millions for some of them, I'm sure. And there's no way to, you know, we created it, we paid for it, and I'm not going to go down that road tonight, but 4,340 peer-reviewed academic studies, none of them on how to deal with this. And that is the issue. And so if you were a prime minister or president of North America, you can get all your institutions to solve some of the basic problems. You can solve, the electric car in one day because there's 4,350 academic studies published and they got nothing to do. And so you get them all to help each other and work together to solve the few little tiny issues we got instead of how to make weapons and destroy this freaking planet with nuclear materials. Now, Building 3, that looks pretty good, right? Doesn't look damaged to me either. According to the NRC, looks fine. At the Senate hearing recently, about a month and a half ago, they sat there and perjured themselves, and the Senate perjured themselves while they were there too, and at it. And this was all streamed live right across in every American's home, and they all sat there and watched Oprah and everything else, and nobody paid attention. And the media didn't call them out and said, hey, by the way, that's a lie. Because Building 3 is, it's missing. It was a 10-story building, and the fuel is missing. And the fuel was ejected out of the reactors, as you've seen in the detonations. And this is like a little nuclear explosion. It's not a detonation, not an explosion in a nuclear, like, boom, boom, where you set off a nuclear bomb, but it was a nuclear detonation from the noble gases from Unit 3. Once again, everything is missing. Yet your media is out there telling you everything is fine. Some of them will say, oh, it's melted reactors. They're not going to say everything is missing all. Now, each spent fuel pool is just as dangerous as a reactor. And they had 3,000, like I was showing you earlier, 3,450 assemblies, right? Let me get that headline for you. So that one had 3,450 assemblies that were ejected right out of the reactor. Now, one and two, they melted through the reactors, through the containment, through the building, through the 100-foot of topsoil like butter, and then down into the seabed, the riverbed underneath it. And Fukushima was built on a riverbed, and it has a mountain behind it. And so the mountain flushes the water out. Let me keep going before I lose track of what I'm doing, because you know as me, I can lose track if I want to. So there was a rapid meltdown at reactor number 2 and 3, and that was indicated by the black smoke. Now, but the building is actually missing. It destroyed itself, and it threw those rods all over the site. And so we have homeless people running around not understanding how much danger they're in, and the nuclear industry keeping their mouth shut because they don't want to go in there, and they'd rather murder the homeless because they're actually cowards. That's what's actually going on. Now, Japan Nuclear Agency on April the 20th admitted that the fuel had melted in reactor 1, 2, and 3. But try getting Fox News to tell you that. Try to get CNN to tell you that. Try to get BBC to tell you to get that. Try to get anybody out there to tell you that in the average day media or people, and put it into perspective to actually go out and get a nuclear scientist, not a pundit, not a mouthpiece, an apologist, but an actual scientist to break it down and ask the pertinent questions, it seems to be impossible. And so that's why we exist, unfortunately, not because we want to. Who the hell wants to do this job? You know, they were trained to do it. You know, you think about the EPA and Environmental Protection Agency and Health Canada, you know, and I showed you a couple nights ago in the last Fukushima one what Health Canada had done, detected the plume. They had the graphs, and we showed you live streaming, and they never told us. We paid them to do that job. That's the job we paid them to do, and when it happened, they turned their backs on us. So, once again, Japan confirmed full meltdown at all three reactors on June the 6th, but yet we still have to fight about it. We still have to argue about it. We have to sit here and have people attack us and demonize us like Thunderfoot, like D News. You know, they are the attack dogs. And then, you know, I had KRQE Channel 13 come after me personally, like a badge of honor. And TEPCO is actually owned by the government. The government owns more shares in TEPCO than the TEPCO Corporation itself, because they're one and the same. And this is just like the inside crew started up TEPCO to get the government contracts. Do you think that the nuclear industry is going to give nuclear stuff like this to any old corporation? No. This was set up from day one. Now, if you ingest radioactive particles, they sequester in your organs, they sequester in your bones, they go right for you, like cesium-137 will go right for your heart, but there was 90 times more strontium to 100 times more strontium. And so some of the numbers are really, really, really frightening. But it goes into your lungs, of course, it gets right to your body, and there's no way to get it out of your body. And so let me just digress, not really, but I didn't mean digress, but let me just expand on this part here. I'm digressing from what I was talking about and what I got here to show you. I just want to make sure I mentioned that, and I forgot to put the links below tonight, didn't I? And I'll get them in after. There's links there for DCA. We're seeing some amazing results with DCA. And you can go see a compound chemist at a local pharmacy. One of them will have it, and they can actually make stuff. A compound chemist is somebody who can cook it up on the site if it's legal to do that. And DCA has no patent on it. It had no adverse side effects associated with it. It's been used in many, many experiments for exotic diseases. And I personally have seen some pretty amazing things with DCA. It's caustic, and so you have to be careful, mix it well. But it's extraordinary. What it does is unplates your blood. It's a very simple thing. It unplates your blood. And that will reduce the breast, pituitary glands, lung, liver, brain cancers by 70%. So if you got a tumor, it can reduce the tumor by 70% in 3 weeks. And these studies have been repeated now in quite a few times in the last 7-8 years at other institutions, and they got the same results. There's no patent, you don't need a doctor prescription, it can't harm you. A coffee is actually worse. But what it does, it unplates your blood. And so cancer and leukemias can't operate in that environment. You know, where I'm definitely going to be doing like a whole video on DCA in the near future, because I've discovered, and in my personal life by using it and doing different things with it, and people that are dying were sent home to die, that their kidneys and their livers have almost rejuvenated themselves in about, 6 weeks now, 7 weeks? Sent home to die. And the doctors say, we don't know what's going on. It's like a miracle, because only 2% of people survive chemotherapy. Now, he's had this most of his life, and his body was polluted. And when I found out about it, we got to DCA, got him to talk to his doctor. Everything was okay. And this guy is out walking his dog. He gave his dog away because he knew he wasn't coming out of that hospital. Now he got his dog back a couple of weeks ago. Should have seen that. I seen that. That was amazing. But we'll get him in a video in the very near future and celebrate that. Because he shouldn't be walking around. They put him up there on the fourth floor to die, and they don't understand why he came out. Because they ran out of money they were going to spend on him for leukemia, and all of a sudden you're giving him more leukemia, and he doesn't understand not to stop taking it, but his kidneys are still repairing themselves. We think we got him convinced at this stage, but it shows you how stupid people are. I hate to say that about anybody, but 2% survival rate. If I gave you $1 million and said, here's a casino, it was 50-50, here's a casino, you got a 2% chance of winning, which one are you going to walk into? Like, you can't treat cancer with nuclear man-made radioactive material because your body is not acclimated to it. It can never be. There's nothing on the planet, 8.8 million species on the planet, and nothing is immune to man-made radioactive material. So how can you expect the 2% that survives was just pure luck? They probably had a really good diet of healthy foods, right? Let me keep going. But it's really cool. Now, CNN said Fukushima in 2012 was only 7% as bad as Chernobyl. 7% as bad as Chernobyl. Well, what you're looking at is Unit 3. That's 2 million times worse than any other reactor on the planet. It's 3 times the size as Chernobyl. It was 100% meltdown. It's actually missing. All the fuel pools are also missing, and they're just the same as any other reactor. They're the animosity equivalent in radiation. That's why they're in the fuel pool, because they're extraordinarily dangerous. That's why they're supposed to be locked away for millions of years, because uranium-238 and the plutonium combinations that go through the chain reaction and ionization will last for billions of years. But so that makes it 18 million times worse than Chernobyl. 18 million times worse than Chernobyl. And where's those crazies too? Hang on. Did I jump all the way over there? I wonder. I got no idea what I'm doing. Hang on. I'll click something at some point and get where I was. Full meltdown. Reactors. Oh yeah, well, let me jump over. They found the missing cores. They're scattered all over Japan. Does that make any sense to anybody besides me? Because that's where they were. And I kind of got things. Yeah, here's the CNN. Let me go back to that one. So Fukushima only 7% as bad as Chernobyl, but it's 18 million times worse, and it's missing. Chernobyl was a 30% meltdown. Chernobyl was one-third the size of any of the reactors at Fukushima. Chernobyl, they put 1 million people in there. They conscripted 600,000 soldiers. 600,000 soldiers. Dana, clean my room. You're looking at Unit 3. I'll clean it next time. 600,000 soldiers, and they ran out on the roof of that building, and they went out there 15 or 20 seconds and threw a piece off the roof, and then they went home. And in Fukushima, they keep them there till they die, till they're ready to die, till they're bleeding out of their orifices, and then they cheat them out of their minimum wage. That's how serious it is, dear. You know, rain caused, during all of this, radioactive rain, caused 130 schools in Korea to close. What do you think they closed at? But the rain in California was 10 times more. Let me cover that for a minute. Yeah, let me just start on that part for you. Fire balloons. Now, Japan was sending over these balloons with bombs on it and incendiary devices. And these devices only took a few days to cross the ocean. And they were found in Alaska, Washington, Oregon, California, Arizona, Idaho, Montana, Utah, you can read the rest, and Mexico and Canada. In a few days, it made it there, because that's what the jet streams do, right? So, now the nuclear fallout map, you see in the top left-hand corner, says 3,000 rads. I want you to think about something I'm going to show you coming up here, if I can find it. I probably won't. Well, we'll keep going here. Hang on. I got lots of clicking. Well, radioactive hot particles bombarded the west coast of U.S. and Canada, December 27, 2011. Now, what that means, and I'll bring up a scale. So we were talking about, let's go back to the New York Times article for a second. Japan raises the contained meltdown after two blasts and third reactors. So the blast looked like that. The melted reactors, one looks like that. And, you know, even though you see only the top burnt off, it's still a million sievers outside of it. Now, what I want you to think about is that all of this stuff that's going on down there. Oh, I'm supposed to go to my video. I got a little video, but there's no audio. And so, as that came out, it didn't stop coming out. This is a 40-day model by NOAA, but it didn't stop coming out. Now, this is just based upon the 137. And cesium-137 is produced as a byproduct of the fuel rods breaking down and going through the chain reaction, the uranium and the plutonium. Now, this was based upon Unit 1. Just Unit 1, and I'll show you Unit 1. So that's Unit 1. So the model is only based up on that one only. It's not based up on the other reactors. Now, when I was showing you that headline, or I'm going to show you a headline for a second. Rain with 20,000 or 20 million particles of radioactive iodine 131 per liter. If you drink that, it'll kill you. Fell on the U.S. during post-Fukushima peak. Now, they based that also on Unit 1, what they call a peak. That there was 14 nuclear plants in Japan that went into heart attack modes, like I showed you earlier. Now, 20 million particles. Now, iodine don't travel alone. And so that's why, and I'll go back to this one, 20 million particles, and iodine 131 per liter. So I want you to remember those words as I give you the model again. So 20 million per liter of rain. So you walk in the rain, you got 20 million liters. Now you also got just as much, 10 times as much as iodine 132 as iodine 131, because they don't travel alone. And that ionizes and radiates the thyroid gland 9 times more effectively. And you have 30 times more iodine-133. Now I'll come back to this one here. So you had 10 times more iodine-132, which ionizes and radiates the thyroid gland, with that at the same time, but they didn't look for that, even though that was going to be present for sure. And if you had a look, you would have found 30 times more iodine-133, and that's just as bad on the thyroid. But even if it's thyroid, if you put iodine when it was coming through, you're still going to ingest the iodine and all the radioactive elements anyway. It's just meant to make you feel better. It actually doesn't do anything. Yeah, it might save your thyroid for a little bit. When you ingest that much, it's irrelevant, see? Because it's only a temporary solution, and it never stopped coming out of there. This was just a 40-day dispersal model I showed you of NOAA's. Now, at the same time, there would have been a massive amount in that same liter, a liter, like a pop bottle liter. So there would have been cesium-137 all over North America at the same time, and that attacks the heart, and so your pets and your friends and your families that died of heart attack in the last couple of years, I'd be highly suspecting that this played a major role in that. And this affects the heart very quickly. It's not slow acting, it attacks it. If you have a weak heart, then it will get you if you were in that environment. And everybody in North America, according to it, was in that environment. And let me play that one more time so you can actually wrap your mind around it. It was only based upon one reactor. But it wasn't, you know, they didn't include the fact that there would have been 100 times more strontium. And strontium is just as bad, or worse by far, actually in my books, from what I understand, than cesium-137. But see, cesium-137 is a signature for the ruptured fuel rods. Now, when I show you this picture coming up here, where are the fuel rods? They aerosol and atomize, but they weren't into that. They weren't into this model. That unit 3 you just looked at wasn't in this model. And so all the fuel pools and everything wasn't in this model. And so, why are they lying to you and making things up? And speaking of that, let's cover this one for a second. So this is what mainstream media claims is Unit 4. Now, I'm going to show you Unit 4 for a second. Now, that's two official pictures. Now, that's Unit 4 too. So how can you have both? Now, how could you have a detonation but still have a perfectly intact pool? It's very confusing, or at least it should be. And so, that's in the right-hand corner of the left picture is Unit 4, and then the people standing there allegedly were standing in front of Unit 4, and CBC, and CBS, Seth Dorn, BBC, and all the media in the last number of months have come out and said that the fuel pool showed this, and inside, walking around, said inside of Unit 4. And so here's Unit 4. Now, can you imagine inside a reactor, there's the fuel pool, you can see it in the left with a circle around it, and here's the one on the right. Now, because of the detonations, and we had some serious detonations, because of those detonations, do you really think for a second that Molly Maid went in there or anybody else was able to get in into these destroyed buildings? Because it's covered, it's peppered, it was projectiles, not just from the fuel pools, the 3,450 assemblies every 2 months that they put into the fuel pools. And because they went through the chain reaction again, they're many millions of times more deadly. And all the nuclear fuel pools had plutonium into it. See, March 18, 2011. And that's why I went way back looking, and this is what I ended up with. Now, I want you to think about how bad it is for Japan. There's one street where 7 people died on a shopping street since Fukushima. And that was September the 8th, so little less than a year and a half after, and 7 people had died on one street. Does that make you wonder what else should not be told? Now, the basements of Reactor 5 and 6, we don't talk about very much, containing, there's a number of these numbers out there, but 8,000 tons of radioactive water. Well, if I took radioactive water and threw it around in here, then I couldn't live here, and I couldn't work here, and neither could you. And so, obviously, these buildings, nobody should ever be going inside of them again. But that's what the nuclear industry does. It creates these environments like the Techo River, 7,500 communities evacuated permanently in Russia, and 9,000 square miles permanently evacuated. You have Chernobyl, where it's 3,500 square miles permanently evacuated till the end of time. You have, think about that one, 3,500. Imagine if I said to you, hey, I'm going to give you 3,500 square kilometers. You can't grow nothing there, and you can never use it because it's got radioactive fallout, and that's going to expand with each storm and bad weather and seasons, and creatures that are going through, they're going to get contaminated and mutate and everything else, and slowly but surely get eradicated. Look, I want you to look at this headline, 5.5 million in the first paragraph on the bottom of it, per month. Now, this is official government site. This is what they were quoting. They were firing every month in Iraq, and half of that was depleted uranium rounds, munitions. And there's another name for them. They're called dirty bombs. But the fact that they fired 5.5 million bullets a month for 9 years, 12 months a year, to get 11,000 people, doesn't mean they're the worst shot on the planet. It just means they were mass murderers. And so if you think the nuclear industry is any different, you got a lot to learn. The radioactive water reached 3,200 kilometers east of Fukushima 6 months before September the 18th. And once again, uh, It takes 130 days at 2 miles an hour to cross the ocean. 131 days to go from Japan to Canada to the United States. 131 days of the Kuroshio currents. Now, those currents, I got a little graph for you. Now, it comes out of the Fukushima plant, and what it does is it goes right up the coast towards the Philippines. And now, as it moves up the coastline, it starts getting slugged out, what you call vacuum out, like a back eddy. And that brings it out towards where the Kuroshio Current picks up and goes across the Pacific to North America. So it starts coming up the coastline, radioactive material. Now, so that whole coastline is very dangerous, obviously, because this has been going on for a long time. And now it comes out and it meets up offshore with the Kuroshio Current. And as it picks up speed and gets out there, it's like a vacuum cleaner sucking it out now. And it's been doing that for millenniums, for billions of years. Now, once it gets out, this is just a short dispersal model of what they figure between March and 2012. Now, you got to realize that it actually goes 5,500 miles every 130 days. Now, it's not like it was just a single plume that came out of there. See, that's the problem with all these models. Think of St. Paddy's Day, 1,440 minutes in a day. So take 1,440. Times 1,217 or 18 days. That's the equation. I'll put 1,218 in there, and we go equal. That's that many. That is 1.7 million. 1.7 million St. Paddy's Day. 1.7 million St. Paddy's Day into the Pacific Ocean. And these elements, because they've been through the ionization and through the chain reaction, again, means none of them are short life. Even those iodines that they lied about and said they were short life, they're not even short life. We're almost through it. What else have I got for you? Now, you remember that headline here. 7 people die on one street. Well, think about what a sitting professor in Britain, a very prestigious at Oxford.
And nobody has died of radiation at Fukushima, but hundreds have died from the...
7 people died on a shopping street. But there's a... Like, I'm not going to go down that road tonight, but there's so many people that have died working there as cleanup workers, and it's just an endless conversation. And so the whole planet has literally been just brainwashed. And they are at this for a long time. They're very good at it. They get our children when they're young, and they destroy their mind with political fluff and ideologies and also programming to be slaves. Now, if you go to a private school, children are academically taught. In your public schools, they're taught to be, they're given a lobotomy education, is the better way to put it. You get an education, but you also get a lobotomy at the same time. Now, in Fukushima, they take the they got a couple of billion tons, and they grind it up, and they put it in the incinerators, and, 100 to 300,000 becquerels of man-made radioactive materials are liberated back into the environment per kilogram. So say 300,000 becquerels a kilogram. So let me clear that. I don't know what I'm doing sometimes. So 300,000 becquerels, 30,000. So I screwed up, didn't I? So 300,000 becquerels in a kilogram. Well, what you got to do is you got to multiply that by around 26 to get a cubic meter. And that's a better number to work with, because that's where your kid stands up in a cubic meter when they're waiting for the school bus. And so you got 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3. So 30 million becquerels. Turn it off this time. 30 million becquerels in a cubic meter where your kid is standing up waiting for the bus. And the whole country is radiated anyway. And instead of trying to deal with it, trying to do something about it, spend money and have a solution, rather than take the 1,600 universities they got there and try to find solutions for their people, for their future generation, they're looting the country, looting the system itself, and murdering everybody by keeping everything hidden away from them and not, never giving them the opportunity. And they're doing the same to the rest of the planet. It wasn't just hot particles that really bombarded the US and Canada. It got the whole friggin' planet. It got the whole entire planet, because it didn't stop coming out of there. It started, it's not like one plume that came out of there, okay? It's nonstop. There's 1,440 plumes. There's 1,000 pounds of radioactive material a minute going into the ocean. Imagine having a truck, 1,440 trucks a day, 1,000 pounds of dye, and you got to dump it in the river. And so every minute, you got to go up, back a truck down to the river, and you got to dump in 1,000 pounds of dye. And you got to get the truck out of the way, get the next truck down there, dump in 1,000 pounds of dye. But the dye stays, it's radioactive, and it stays bright like what you see for thousands of years. Would you get it then? Would you understand the urgency at that stage? Would if media come out and told you that, you would get it, and you'd probably be over looting your next door neighbor's house, because they would not tell you how to deal with it or anything else, and they won't even try. And that's what I keep saying to you. 4,340 peer-reviewed academic studies that are published every day, and none of them on how to deal with this. None of them on how to put this stuff in, right? Because then they would have to admit there's a problem. And they won't admit it till they kill us. They won't admit it till they end the planet and every species on it. They have no intentions of stopping. Even if they said they went and stopped, they would still secretly be doing it somewhere. These people make money from murder, and there's so many of them out there, and they murder their way into power, and then everybody's kept in this false left-right paradigm where they're arguing over nonsense when the boogeyman, the three melted reactor gorilla in their living room, and they can't see it because they're too busy in fluff. You can't see the radioactive material here. If it was, you couldn't see each other driving down the road. If you could actually, if the radioactive material that was released and continues to fall out had colors, we wouldn't be able to leave our house or feed ourselves because we couldn't find a fridge. We're in a snowstorm of radioactive material, and we have, it takes 5, 10, 15, 20 years for the cancers to manifest. And I should say that at the beginning of every show, because that's how they're getting away with it. They know the cancer is not going to show up. And so because of that, you know, their first reactions are always going to be...
My name is Martin Fackler. I am the Tokyo Bureau Chief. And the title, as we just heard, was Challenges and Opportunities After the Fukushima Nuclear Disaster. Now we're going to look at the other side of the nuclear coin, if you will, which is civilian nuclear use, this crisis management. And the question of what do you tell your public? You know, I mean, do you tell them that there's a serious nuclear accident, or do you play it down? Do you try to cover it up?
So according to them, that's what they've really done. They keep playing it down. They keep covering it up. They'll come out with some good information, but nobody carries it. Nobody shoves it out there. Fox and CNN and all them are not going to talk about those articles. They'll only talk about the stuff that they can use. I mean, for them to come out and say a year later at CNN that it's 7% of Chernobyl, that's a crime, because they know better. They know everything I know and much, so much more, and yet they refuse to do something about it because it's a multi-trillion-dollar-a-year murder machine. A nuclear scientist can't tell the difference between a 12-foot nuclear fuel rod and a banana. It's outrageous. It's shocking. It's heartbreaking. It's despicable. And every professor in every university and every graduate, every nuclear scientist in the media equates man-made radioactive materials with bananas, but a banana is homeostasis. And so if you, what that means is like a thermostat or a cruise control on your car, how it regulates, like a thermostat regulates your heat and a cruise control regulates your speed. Well, homeostasis when it comes to food with potassium 40, if you eat a banana, you off-gas the same amount of potassium 40 because your body can't hold anymore. And so no matter what food you're eating, it's got insignificant, normal, indigenous, everyday background radiation. It's stupid, but they got this into the equation. I have to apologize all the time because they claim it's like walking in the sunshine. They claim man-made radioactive materials like eating a banana. They claim man-made radioactive material is like eating potato chips, but yet they're homeostasis. So if you eat it, you can't get any more. But if you ingest a single radioactive element, a particle from Fukushima, you will in 5, 10, 15, 20 years get cancer. If you ingest a lot of it, and according to the experts, you know, we were bombarded with that material, sustained April, May, June, July, August, September, October, November, as it was sustained coming out of the melted reactors. And not only that, they poured water on those reactor cores. And the spent fuel pools, if you move that stuff around and the rods break more, you release the volatile noble gases again. And that's what caused the explosions the last time, was the fact that that was the issue, right? Now these cores, there's no core in Unit 3. Some of it blew out and the rest of it melted down and has gone down into the earth. And so that's all I got for you tonight. That's all I got for everybody tonight. But just remember, on March 13, 2011, that the Washington Post had that headline there. And so why didn't all the other media repeat that? Because it was true. We got it at Harvard. We got it at Stanford. We got it at C-SPAN with the NRC sitting there lying, saying, and I mean, they lied and they say, there's no structural integrity to number 4 and that everything is intact. There's the fuel pool and there's the fuel pool. Both of these are official pictures and they still are. Where that fuel pool, that beautiful shiny fuel pool is not inside of that building, right? The top right-hand corner, the right-hand corner, see that? That's that green thing you see there. That's the same thing. The green you see up in the right-hand corner of this picture here, that's the same thing. And so you couldn't get in there and repair all that. You're not going to see anybody in there with scaffolding or with cutting torches or anything else. It's a total fabrication. So your media lied to you about that. So, and try to keep focusing on that as if that was the issue. The issue was, and still is, and will continue to be, that it's not stopped coming out of there. It's probably never going to stop coming out of there. And that there's 1,000 pounds of it going into the ocean every minute. And that is the animosity equivalent of the death of all life on the planet in the future. Because it takes a number of years for this to kick in. But I want you to understand that a glass of salt water has 75 to 100 million phytoplankton. They're the basis of the food chain. They're the basis of the oxygen. If I drop a radioactive element in there, uranium, iodines, anything in there, cesium, strontium, it will kill all those creatures. And I can dump it in another glass, it will kill all those creatures in record times because it pulses out energy and nothing can live and nothing has a tolerance for these emitters. Okay, folks, good night, everybody. Linda Davis, Standing Foot, hi, bud. And Checks and Balances, Candace, MSS, VS, Stacey Anderson, Mayla Reason. Yeah, he's pro-nuke. Yeah, you're right. Thank you, Marla. And David, Foggy Range, Stacey Anderson. Let's say goodnight to a few people for a takeoff here. Night Raven, Lori Reedman, in HD, Ronald McKnight. And Nom Nom, Euro prop, hey buddy. Haven't seen you. I know it's different time zones. Hard for you to get here. You've been around for quite a few years. We're always happy to see you. It's hard to catch you sometimes, my friend, but it's always good to see you. Siegfried, Lunar, Ronald McKnight. I think we got Tree Hugger. Let me see anybody I'm missing. Stacy Anderson, hugs for you, sweetie. Lori, you too. And everybody else, Irina Rell. We got. We'll put the links back on our neat after. And also, let me see. Shanigans, Lori, Slippery Pixel. I can't keep up with it. I'll come back down and let it scroll up as I wind it and shut it down just in case there's somebody true in a comment. Daisy May. Yeah, turn off your wireless internet, folks. Your old prop is right. Fred, Daisy May, Don, Michael, everybody, Klondike, Fred Davis, BJ, Bizzle, France, and we'll catch you folks on the rebound. That was a good stream tonight. My voice is so raw, I can't even yell anymore, so I guess that day had to happen at some point, right? 56 minutes, that was respectable. We'll catch you folks tomorrow night. I'll be back swinging.